Professor Dave again, let's continue with virus-cell interactions.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
Let's review some basic terminology. We've gone over certain terms as they relate to viral infection of bacteria, but let's make sure we understand each of them in the context of multicellular hosts as well. To clarify, a host is an organism that supports the growth of a virus, which could be a unicellular organism, as we saw in the previous tutorial, but this can also mean animals, including humans. An infection in this context refers to a virus that is successfully reproducing in a host. And disease refers to an abnormal state of a host. When a host cell and a virus encounter each other, our body's barrier defenses and immune systems, both innate and adaptive, work to prevent or control infection of the organism as a whole. Viruses cause disease after they break through the natural protective barriers of the body and evade the immune system. From there, the virus might trigger a destructive immune and inflammatory response. Or it might kill cells of an important tissue, like the brain, for instance. Ultimately, the ability of the immune system to control the infection determines both the duration and severity of the disease. Now that we've got those basics down, let's move on to some more involved aspects of a virus-host interaction. For any given virus, the host range refers to the spectrum of species that are susceptible to an infection with that virus. It turns out that most viruses have a pretty narrow range, and most viruses, but not all, are able to infect only one species. Now let's think about this from the perspective of disease. A disease can be caused by multiple viruses that have a common tissue preference, also called a tropism. For instance, viruses with a liver tissue tropism can cause hepatitis, or those with a tropism for upper respiratory tract tissue can cause the common cold. On the other hand, one virus might cause several different diseases, or no observable symptoms at all. An example of this is herpes simplex virus, or HSV, type 1. This virus can cause encephalitis, genital herpes, pharyngitis, or several other diseases depending on what kind of tissue it infects. Like bacteria, many viruses encode virulence factors that increase the efficacy of their replication or transmission, the binding of the virus to its target tissue, or the immune escape of the virus. These factors may not be essential for growth of the virus in something like tissue culture, but are necessary for survival or pathogenicity in a host cell. If a virus loses its virulence factors, we refer to the virus as attenuated. The portal of entry of a virus is often through mucous membranes, but viruses can also enter through skin abrasions, insect bites, or other breaks in the skin, though it is less common. In general, the skin serves as an excellent barrier to infection, and actually, inhalation is probably the most common route of viral infection. These infections can remain localized at or near the portal of entry, like in the case of a respiratory infection, or they might spread to a secondary target organ, which is called a disseminated infection. An example of this is the measles virus, which enters in the respiratory tract, but can spread to other organs. The extent of disease caused by a virus depends on a few factors, including 1. The nature of exposure to the virus, 2. The general health, age, and immune status of the person, 3. The viral dose, and 4. The genetics of the host and the virus. Viral disease in the human body progresses through a series of defined steps, similarly to how a virus enters and replicates in a cell. Let's take a look at these steps. First, we have acquisition, or entry into the body. The second step is initiation of infection. After an infection is initiated, the next step is an incubation period, where the virus is amplified and may spread to a secondary location. From here, we see replication of the virus in the target tissue, which is what causes the observable signs of disease. Next up, our immune system responds, either limiting or contributing to the disease. The virus is then produced and released, causing contagion. Finally, the disease is either resolved or continues as a persistent infection or chronic disease. As with bacterial diseases, viral infections can be asymptomatic during the incubation period, or they might cause non-specific early symptoms, which we call the prodrome. Ultimately, symptoms of a viral disease are caused by tissue damage or potential systemic effects, either caused by the virus itself or by the immune system's response. To be clear, immune responses can have both positive and negative effects. In some cases, the immune system may control the spread of the virus by eliminating the virus and virus-infected cells from the host. In such a case, the infection is resolved. In other cases, however, viruses can cause immunopathology, where an immune response is triggered that harms the host. On the milder end of the spectrum, we might see simple inflammation, which just refers to pain, redness, heat, and swelling caused by cytokines that are released by immune system cells in response to the virus. Context is critical here, though. An acute, regulated, local case of inflammation is generally a good sign, while chronic, systemic inflammation is more destructive and worrisome. If the virus spreads, it might trigger a hypersensitivity reaction via our adaptive immune system, which can be absolutely devastating. The lymphatic system and bloodstream are the primary avenues for viral transfer within the body once an infection is established. The term viremia refers to the transport of viruses in the blood. Viruses can also gain access to the central nervous system or the brain through several routes. And finally, viral infection is considered resolved when all infectious viruses and virus-infected cells are cleared from the body. Now that we've got some information about how viruses move around the body of a host, let's move forward and talk about how viruses spread between hosts. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.